The February 12th edition of the City Council Study Session Meeting. I'd like to welcome those in the audience and also those at home who may be watching on Channel 21 instead of watching the State of the Union speech tonight, which is on as we're speaking.
Oh, there goes our audience.
There goes the audience, yes.
Sure, it's just the
My name is Tom O'Dell. I have the honor and distinct privilege of being your mayor. And I want to say that tonight we're going to deviate a little bit from the planned agenda. We'll be taking the second item first, and that's the Ebrite Creek Monitoring and Enhancement Report, pardon me. And then we'll do the Planning Commission handoff. But before we start, I'd like us all to rise for the pledge, and I'd like to ask Caleb to lead us in it.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So the first actual business on the agenda this evening is public comment. This is an opportunity for the public to address the council. We have offer 3 minutes per person, or 5 minutes if you are representing the official position of a recognized community organization. And Cameron, do we have a sign-up sheet?
Yeah.
What I will do is I will go through the sign-up sheet first, calling people in the order in which they signed up. We have a relatively short list this evening. When we're done, I will ask twice if there's anyone else in the audience who wishes to address the council, and after that, we'll move on. So the first person I have is Mark Cross, and Mark, you know the drill. Name and address for the record, please.
Who?
Yes, my name's Mark Cross. I live at 247 208th Avenue Northeast here in Sammamish. I wanted to first thank Laura Philpott for the response to the slide on our block. It was between two houses, the Taylors and the Wichters, and it was really appreciated by both families. I hope Ken Taylor can come and say that as well. It is a difficult situation because the property is on a private right-of-way. But I think also it should help inform the decisions that you're being asked to make on the critical area code and also on the landscaping for Ebrite Creek. Currently, because the storm drain pipe that was dug into a hillside, your code does not currently require that there be vegetation put back on that steep slope. And I think that's something that other cities are doing to try to make sure that slopes that get disturbed don't have as much slide problems. So that's something you can work on. The second thing I'd like you to see in looking at the two items on your agenda tonight is that here you are approving a plan to put native vegetation along the edges of Ebrite Creek in an attempt to enhance the salmon ability to return and to prosper here in Sammamish. Yet at the same time, you have a Planning Commission recommendation to you that recommends reducing or eliminating buffers and wetlands across the city in many different places, and simply allowing people to take chunks out of wetlands that are half the size of this room for no particular good reason. And we can see that they are related to water quality. The final point I'd make is that you have a recommendation not to take over the Friends of Pine Lake water quality monitoring at Ebrite Creek, but you have in the recommendation from the Planning Commission the idea of doing development on steep and highly erodible soils that will require monitoring, but there's no monitoring plan that's been brought to you, nobody to pay for it, and no way to have a baseline. Without a baseline, you can't tell how much development above it is helping or hurting in the situation. So I think you do need to come to grips with the monitoring that's being done, the amount of human waste that runs thick along with animal waste in these streams, and that as you monitor these other places, I think you're going to find that you really do need to work with other agencies to see what can be done to identify failed septic tanks and people who could employ better animal husbandry techniques to reduce the amount of fecal material in our streams. And this would potentially balance some of the kind of things that you may want to adopt that come out of the Planning Commission recommendation to balance it. Otherwise, you're simply reducing the wetlands in the city, you're reducing the stream buffers that help support a healthy environment, you're simply putting more phosphorus and more of this material into the lakes and streams that we all appreciate and care for. So I hope you'll take those ideas together and realize that you not only have to plant great plants along the creek, which is an important thing, but you also have to worry about water quality, and there are programs and other agencies that want and can work with you on a reasonable basis to make really big improvements. There's a lot of low-hanging fruit when it comes to water quality here in the city of Sammamish. And as we urbanize, I think it's something that you should turn your attention to. You always are asking, and I know I did when I was on council, what are other cities doing? What are they adopting? Well, one of the things Issaquah is adopting is to work with ecology and with property owners to identify those septic tanks, identify people who are not watching where their horse manure is being piled, and to really be able to make substantial improvements in water quality. We can do it too. It's not expensive. It's not necessarily expensive for the horse owners. And people who are on failed septic systems simply don't have the right to pursue their happiness at the point of putting human waste into the rivers and streams of the city of Sammamish. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Okay, the next person up is Reeve Rockwood.
Oh, yeah, extra copies. Reed Brockway, 167 East Lake Sammamish Shore Lane, Northeast. I hate to rain on anybody's parade, but I'm going to be talking about the ECA process tonight, and I'm going to be rather critical. Our ECA code has some profound problems. It still does. The new draft code revisions just came out, and Citizens for Sammamish will be providing an accounting of those problems, but tonight we want to speak about the process. To some of us, by the way, when I say we, I'm speaking for myself and my wife, Susan, who is here. The we is not Citizens for Sammamish.
You have 3 minutes, Reed.
Pardon me?
3 minutes.
I know. To some of us who worked hard making a case to fix the problems, the Planning Commission phase of this process was a big disappointment. The special issues of some individuals were addressed, like the ability of some to develop in the erosion hazard near sensitive water bodies overlay. But in general, the public testimony was courteously listened to and then filed away and not revisited as the Planning Commission promised to do. The volume of testimony was extreme, 280 some exhibits, some of them big documents or multiple documents. And given that the Commission of Volunteers had to do all its work in two-hour sessions over a couple weeks, over a couple week intervals over many months, perhaps one should ask whether expecting them to digest this massive information would even be reasonable. It probably wasn't. But that's not the main point I want to address here, and I'm not going to pull any punches. Staff commandeered the process and defined the rules so that what the Commission had on the table for deliberations was a version of reality created by staff, which was at odds with much of public testimony. But throughout deliberations, the Commission did not refer back to the testimony. Meanwhile, those rules assured that once deliberations started, the public was silenced. We could not say, wait, you're forgetting about whatever. We can provide ample evidence of how some of the key public issues staff chose not to deal with were distorted and discredited in the course of putting together a story for the Commission. The result was a minimized set of revisions that ignore many of the inequities that exist in the code. In so doing, we are simply passing these problems along to the future. This is in keeping with the assertion staff made at the beginning of the process that this revision is merely a tweak. As you probably remember, Citizens for Sammamish submitted testimony to the December 11th council meeting describing in fair detail how this process was going down. We urge you to be familiar with what that says. Before testimony was closed, Citizen for Sammamish also submitted to the Planning Commission a markup of the so-called deliberations draft of the code changes prepared by staff. In that markup, Citizens for Sammamish identified problems and proposed solutions. It distills a mass of testimony down into a manageable document that the commissioners could have referred to along with staff's material, but they didn't. One sentence. Citizens for Sammamish will be submitting another markup of the version that just came out once we have the time to review it. To be continued.
Okay. Susan Brockway.
Hello, I'm Susan Brockway, 167 East Lake Sammamish Shoreline, Northeast. So to summarize, I have to read. The Planning Commission was hit with a tremendous volume of testimony, probably too much for them to digest. Staff tried to distill it down to something manageable, but in so doing changed and limited the message. The Commission promised to revisit the testimony during deliberations. They did not do this. And the public was silenced at this point with no opportunity to expose oversights or misrepresentations by staff. So many of the problems did not get addressed adequately or at all during deliberations. As a result, many inequities remain in the code. So my plea to you as a council is let's do it right this time. Review the existing testimony yourselves if you can possibly, but please at least listen to the citizens of Sammamish. Listen to Erica Talakas, I'm sorry, am I mispronouncing your name, Theliakis, and the other involved citizens. Listen to AMIC and listen to staff. Then weigh the merits of what each says in the context of science and the law, but don't pretend to be listening, then ignore us, and focus on a version of reality produced by a staff with their stated objective of limiting this revision to a tweak. In many ways, our code is broken and needs to be fixed. The approach that has been taken thus far has made some progress, but is not getting that job done. Invest whatever time and research is necessary to make truly informed decisions, and please do it now. Don't just kick the can down the road. Thank you.
Thank you. Bob Sorensen.
Thank you. I'm Bob Sorensen. I live at 22609 Northeast 2nd Street in Sammamish. I've just handed you a copy of the comments. I'm speaking tonight on behalf of Citizens for Sammamish. Harry Shedd was unable to be here tonight, and he asked if I would read this on behalf of that group. So I will just read it verbatim. To the Sammamish City Council from Citizens for Sammamish Environmental Subcommittee. First of all, we would like to thank and commend the Planning Commission for their lengthy and diligent work on the revisions to the Environmentally Critical Areas Ordinance. The process began well, and there was significant interest in this code revision and much testimony, both from consultants and from the public. While the volume of reports and testimony was varied and large, the PC stayed the course and worked very hard to address the concerns that originally brought about this exercise. In the end, however, the process began slipping, and the end result is less than satisfactory. Here are some of the observations of the Citizens for Sammamish Environmental Subcommittee, who followed this process very closely. The current ECA rewrite process was commissioned by the City Council because of a sunset clause in the original 2005 ECA ordinance, which was inserted in the ordinance because several council members at the time were concerned about some of the overly restrictive provisions, particularly the large buffers on streams and wetlands. This current effort was to examine in part the latest best available science to see if these buffers really needed to be this large and restrictive. An environmental consultant was hired and prepared reports on several ECA topics. The results were disappointing because these reports included very little new best available science and formed their conclusions from the original and rather questionable best available science. Much public testimony was presented about the lack of peer-reviewed science and questionable application of some of the BAS used. This testimony seemed to be dismissed without any meaningful discussion or response. Also, the absence of best available science in a given area was often used as justification for more stringent regulation, such as, since there's no best available science that shows one can develop immediately adjacent to an environmentally critical area without having a negative impact on that ECA. We believe that this data does exist and was simply not sought out or researched by the consultant. The consultant was tasked to look only at best available science, that is natural science, related to protecting our ECAs, and therefore included no technological science that might allow development closer to the ECAs while still providing for the necessary protections. I'm sorry, do I get extra time speaking for a group?
2 minutes.
Thank you. There was no opportunity for the public to engage in a dialogue with the Planning Commission or their consultant. Many questions were raised during the consultant's reports, but the public had no opportunity to question or get clarification of an issue. Public testimony and questions or concerns were usually logged by staff and sometimes responded to, but for the most part were not discussed again nor included in the evaluation forms for deliberation by the Planning Commission. While staff did a good job of providing information to the Planning Commission and cataloging and reporting the various testimonies, there seemed to be a significant bias on the part of staff in the material that was provided to the Planning Commission. And when the time came for evaluation of the various topics, staff prepared all of the evaluation forms, and there seemed a reluctance on the part of the Planning Commission to challenge many of their conclusions. For instance, all of the environmental evaluations were recorded as having positive, neutral, or negative environmental impact based on the current ECA ordinance. This biased the results in that reducing the current environmental restrictions would record as a negative impact, even though, since the existing ECA may have been overly restrictive, there may actually be a totally neutral impact. The original City Council concerns that the existing ECA ordinance was in some instances too restrictive was never considered, nor was there any consideration that technology might offer equal or better protections than simply keeping away from the environmentally critical areas altogether. The role of animal habitat became a significant factor in maintaining the wide buffers adjacent to the ECAs. There was little discussion as to the importance or necessity of wildlife protections, even though there was testimony requesting such discussions. The consultant's reports seem to indicate that while wildlife benefited from the buffers, the animal waste was a pollutant which was detrimental to the environmentally critical areas. There are many other issues with this code revision that we hope the City Council will look into before acting on the recommended code revisions. Some of these concerns have already been presented to City Council, the letter that Reed referred to, and others will come before you during your deliberations. And I'll let you read the rest of it. My time is up. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, that ends the list of those that have signed up to comment this evening. Is there anyone else who wishes to address the council? I see one running for the podium.
Good evening. My name is Larry Martin. I'm a land use attorney with Davis Wright Tremaine. I office in Bellevue, Washington. You know, I've spent over 30 years representing cities and sewer and water districts, and then in the later half of my career, property owners and developers. And on behalf of the Probst, the heirs of the owners of the Probst estate, Mr. and Mrs. Probst have now passed away. On behalf of my clients, I attended virtually every Planning Commission meeting. I think I may have missed one. And it's disheartening to hear from people who don't like the result, that the process was bad, that the motives of people were bad, that the performance of people was improper. Sometimes you have a really good process and really good people putting out really good effort, thinking real hard and coming to good thoughtful results, and they don't agree with what you want. It really disturbs me to hear the staff's efforts and the Planning Commission's efforts called into question, because in my over 30 years of attending thousands of public meetings, I don't think I've ever seen a Planning Commission members work harder or more diligently on an extremely complex subject area. I want to you to know that we did not get everything in their recommendation that I wanted for my clients, but I feel a strong sense of fairness here in trying to be fair to people, volunteers, who put out so much effort as they did in this process. And with your staff members who were equally diligent, I want to commend them. I think they've done an excellent job. It was extremely well documented, analyzed, and I think they're bringing forward to you their best, well-thought-out recommendations. And again, I don't agree with all of them, but it was a good process performed by people who really worked hard and have tried their best to bring you a good product. And I think the dialogue going forward should discuss facts and policy and not impugn the performance of the professionals and volunteers that have worked on our behalf.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. I appreciate your comments. For the record, I'd like to point out that the Planning Commission spent a good year on this and had at least 25 meetings. Is there anyone else who wishes to address the council at this time? Seeing none, I'm going to close public hearing. Public hearing is now closed. We will now move on to the topics of discussion for this evening, and as I said, public comment, not public hearing. As I mentioned earlier this evening, we're going to reverse the order that we're taking the two items in, and we'll do the report on the Ebrick Creek monitoring first. And Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Tonight, we'll be sharing the successes associated with the recent restoration work that has been completed on the Ebrick Creek. In addition, we'll be sharing the current and planned water quality monitoring efforts of Ebrick Creek. So I have tonight our Director of Funds, our Surface Water Management, Senior Surface Water Manager, is here to share us this wonderful results that we've been so excited to see that is happening. Eric?
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Actually, it is very much my pleasure to be here tonight to come and talk to you about a very positive subject. The title, Ebrick Creek is the little creek that could. This year, I'm not sure if you're aware, you may have been updated that we've had very high runs of Kokanee salmon this year. It's likely reflected, it may be some of the ones that we have put in the stream 3 years ago returning in a three-year period, or it actually just could be some four-year adults coming because the lake was in better shape for their rearing. But personally, I'm grateful to play a part in this process. I want to thank the mayor and former Mayor Jaron for being part of the Kokanee Work Group. The Kokanee Work Group actually made what I'm talking about tonight possible by essentially informing us of this grant opportunity that we had late last fall. We're going to talk a little bit more about that, but I also want to remind you to save the date. We're having our Kokanee Fry release on the afternoon of April 26th on the property that we restored. So you'll get to see firsthand, not just from my pictures, the restoration work that was done and how great it looks out there. So tonight, we're going to talk about Ebright Creek. I'm going to touch on two different things. The restoration project that we had that was grant-funded, and we're going to talk about monitoring activities that are currently taking place, both publicly and privately, and then talk about what will be taking place in the future. I don't know how many of you have actually been on Mr. Pereira's property, but this is kind of a little bit of a vicinity map. Just off of the map to the north is where Thompson Hill Road dumps into East Lake Sammamish Parkway at the signal.
Thompson, you mean the traffic you're talking about?
No, I'm sorry, where the two roads intersect. There I go, putting in drainage jargon. So the restoration work was done through a grant with Forterra, formerly the Cascade Land Conservancy, and the grant actually had a 50% match, but as you'll see in the next slide, we were able to take advantage of some private improvements on the Pereira property. One of the conditions was that the funds had to be expended in 2012, and I think that we found out in September that we had to spend $75,000. We signed the contract in October, and we had 10 weeks to do this work with a contractor, both to remove invasives and with the consultant to come up with some preliminary designs that we're going to look at. The contracted consultant was David Evans and Associates, and they did a very good job and met our aggressive timeline. So the matching that we were able to take advantage of on the private property was the replacement of a culvert on Mr. Pereira's property. The upper left shows a 20-inch diameter culvert that drops into a plunge pool that was, for at least the last decade, pretty much a blockage. We hadn't seen significant numbers of fish get above this in the last decade, is what I'm told. And then on the right and lower, you see what it was replaced with. This is a 14-foot box culvert. Some might say it looks a little bit like a bridge, but the design behind that is that the stream wouldn't even know it was going through some bridge or culvert, that it would be assimilated stream bottom. That actually, we call it a box, but it's more like a U shape, that there's actually gravels, natural gravels underneath it. So we had a consultant contract, and we had some goals. We wanted to do basically a site description. We didn't have anything more than an informal understanding of what was out there on the Pereira property, and then actually to the mouth of where Ebright dumps into Lake Sammamish. And so we wanted to look at the site and do a formal survey. We actually had surveyors go out there. And then we wanted a little bit of a preliminary design, something that we could use in the future. Well, first to understand what our needs were, and then also to use it in the future as demonstrating the need. This preliminary design did some hydraulic modeling, and I can't help myself, I'm an engineer, I included a cross-section, vertically distorted, of what we represented as East Lake Sammamish Parkway and the trail, and the blue lines that you see are different flow events from the two-year through the 100-year flow event, and we want to see what happens if we model those through the existing conditions. So that's that picture there. But we also wanted to do something on the ground so we could take some pretty pictures at the end of this grant. I mean, it's nice to show a granting agency that you did more than just plan. And so we did some invasive non-native plant removals, and we partnered with Earth Corps for that. So the site survey was a formal survey that we did. Surveyors spent quite a bit of time out there, and we looked at things that were important to what possibly could be important to future stream design, and we cataloged all the large woody debris that we saw out there, both some naturally occurring, and a lot of it actually was placed on the stream in the early 90s by a project King County did. So we did our hydraulic modeling. We did this mainly to see what kind of deficiencies we may have out there. This is a picture of a wood bridge that's currently on the property. And it was kind of good that we did the modeling, and it showed that this bridge was a constriction in high flows. Mm-hmm. And then so we went out there and talked to the owner and said, well, you know, we see that this may be a constriction. And he confirmed that in high flows, the water actually goes mm-hmm. up and around the bridge. And so it's always nice when our modeling is confirmed with real life conditions. And And one of the things that the preliminary design is giving us is a roadmap for future actions. And so by being able to demonstrate that we have a need, I believe it's going to position us better for future grant opportunities. So we had some design recommendations. The first one I'll talk about are buffer enhancements. We have both invasive non-native species out there. And as it turned out, when we did a little bit of digging, we found that there was some fill, historic fill that was put out there. As my understanding, before Mr. Pereira lived there, there was a concrete contractor. We actually found chunks of concrete right next to the stream. We want to add some large woody debris. There is woody debris out there. It's what my consultants are telling me is it's aging. It's been out there for nearly two decades, and it's done its job pretty good, but it needs to be bolstered, and there's some other things we want to do, trying to kind of keep the stream going where we want the stream to go. And so what I've shown there is I just took a little cutout of the plans that you have in the back of your report that we gave you, and it just shows one little bend in the stream. You know, this bend wasn't even that obvious before we did some of the clearing, but I was out there and I was really surprised. In the high flow event we had this winter, the flow actually didn't take the bend and it went straight. So there was actually flow over the pasture. So what we would hope in the future is to be able to make sure that the stream is where we want the stream to be. And the last thing that the preliminary design did was it addressed the culverts at the parkway and the trail. We wanted them to look specifically at those because those are really public facilities under our control. And so we wanted to see, is there any deficiencies there? So I mentioned the historic fill, and once we found out that there's historic fill, we used the program Google Earth, and we went back in time. It allows you to go back and look at historic photos. And I found this one from the, I think it's dated the early 90s, like 1990, but you can see the light is where the fill is. And if we look at the plan, the bottom half of that light looks just like where our hatched marks are, where we found the fill. So, I mean, we can see it both, you know, on the photograph and actually on the ground where that fill took place. So we want to remove that fill, both to establish more native species there, but the fill's impinging on the floodplain. And so if we can remove that fill, then that allows the stream to behave more naturally, because that stream, you know, even in the time I've been here, has moved quite a bit. It kind of braids itself and then it goes one way, and if we give it more space, it has more space to behave naturally. And then the last thing we wanted to do was the invasive plant removal. I want to mention that we did partner with Earth Corps, and that was partly because we were dealing on private property, and Mr. Pereira had a high confidence that Earth Corps wouldn't do any harm to his property. We talked to him about maybe using volunteers, and he had some concerns with untrained volunteers. And Earth Corps is kind of like AmeriCorps, where they have young people that are making not a lot of money, but have been trained in this. And so we were confident that they would know exactly what they were supposed to do and what they weren't supposed to do. We're going to talk a little bit about next steps on the invasive removal, but I wanted to show you some pretty cool pictures. In the upper left, in the next three slides, is what it looked like before, and in the lower right is what it looked like after we got done. In some cases, it doesn't even look like the same picture. Also, I couldn't help myself, but I put some pictures of the kokanee that were actually taken in Ebright Creek. These pictures were taken, and they're pretty cool pictures, actually. Breeding pairs. So you see that there's a gentleman in the background and it's just covered in blackberries, and then in the after picture you can even see where the stream goes.
Is that Mayor Odell on that picture, Eric?
I don't believe so.
I don't have the red waders.
That's Don's waders.
And here's yet another picture. I was really impressed with the work after they got done. I couldn't believe how much clearer it looked. And you can't tell from this photo, but you could probably from the report that I gave you, but not only did we take out those invasive species, but we planted in some species that we wanted to. Large firs, evergreen trees that eventually will grow up and provide us very good habitat. So the invasive plant removal that we did, if you look to the right side of this photograph where the number four is, that first bend, we kind of just, that area, if you kind of drew a circle around that bend, we got about 9,000 square feet done. But the rest of the yellow all needs to happen. And so what I want to talk to you a little bit about is an opportunity we might have with the King Conservation District. Now, the King Conservation District has money in an account set aside for Sammamish, and I've actually met on site with the King Conservation District, and they have a program that they actually have their own crews. So we could both contract with them to grant reimburse us to hire crews, or we could just contract with them to have their crews do it, and they would just deduct it directly out of the account that has our grant monies in there. That's very appealing to me because we're a contract city, but contracts take time to do. And anytime we can directly contract with an agency, I have high confidence both, number one, that their crews are very well trained, and that we would get a very good value using the King Conservation District staff.
Eric, is this direction acceptable to Mr. Perea?
Now, I know his concern was with volunteers, mm-hmm. And so we would of course check in with him. So I can't say that it is, but we would check in with him before we did that, and that I think that his concern was mainly with people coming and running roughshod, and I don't believe right. that the King Conservation District crews would be doing that. And so one of the things I put up here was that it's been the privilege of the staff to be active in the Kokanee work group, and I want to point out that both our mayor and former mayor Don Jaron are very active members of that group, and it's exciting. We're the only city that has our electeds on that group, and so it just shows how important that is to us.
We also have some citizens that they're very active in that group. So Eileen Stahl is sitting there. So
yes, actually, Erica active. Is in a lot of those meetings. There's a lot of citizens that are actually involved in that group. But Erica and I believe Eileen is the nominated baker. No, she makes our little Kokanee cookies every year for the fry release.
Eric, just for the benefit of those who may not be familiar with the group, could you kind of recap the membership, the governments, and the NGOs and et cetera?
I will try, but please fill in if I miss out on anything. But my understanding is that we are one of the largest groups of kind of a, we're not a group, we like to actually say that we're not formally recognized as an organization, but all the partner organizations have donated staff time, and NGOs have come and donated their time. So just off the top of my head, Trout Unlimited is active. Non-governmental organization. Those are things like Trout Unlimited and Save Lake Sammamish. Mm-hmm. And Friends of Pine Lake, I'm sorry. Yes, and Friends of Pine Lake. And there's representatives from King County, Issaquah, Redmond, Bellevue, Sammamish, the tribe, Snoqualmie Tribe.
Trout Unlimited?
Yeah, Trout Unlimited.
Fish?
Department of Fish and Wildlife. Actually, that's one of the, what I feel is one of the strengths of the group, is that we have both Washington State and the U.S. Department of Fish and Wildlife. They're there and they're caring about these little kokanee. The Federal Department of Fish and Wildlife have been forming a program that will fit into the Sammamish area almost ideally. They're helping form the program, and then we're applying for the program, so we have a high confidence that we might be successful in that.
I've had comments that this is a being held up in various places as a classic example of how a public-private partnership should work, and the results so far have been very, very good. We need to keep on it. What we're doing with Ebright Creek is fundamentally step one, if you will. There are a number of creeks that feed into Lake Sammamish, which have in the past supported kokanee populations, and with some little bit of tender love and care in the future, might be able to have them come back. In fact, this year's run, we've seen not only at Ebright, but a good half a dozen other creeks around the area. So it's working.
Okay. So the last bullet here, and I've mentioned that before, is that now that we have a plan in place for the stream that has kind of identified projects, and we can actually take those projects and break them up in a logical sense, we can watch for grants that may be good and well-fitting.
Eric, could you also address the Bad Creek monitoring issue?
Yes, actually, it's my next slide.
Okay.
Ebrad Creek monitoring.
Before you go on, Nancy, did you want to say something?
Yes, very timely.
They're redoing the trail and going to be paving it under the master plan. I think this coming year, not 2013, but 2014. If I'm correct, there would be an opportunity, and I know we ceded the permit authorization to the county in regard to the trail work, but you mentioned that this identified the culvert at the trail and at the road. What about looking at, sooner than later, about working with the county on doing any work that needs to be done on the culvert as part of the reconstruction of the trail?
I'll ask the Public Works Director to respond to that.
I think that's a great idea, that we should look for opportunities to work with their project, and we are staying on top and communicating with the project team associated with the paving of the trail. So we will work with the city manager and with the county to look for funding opportunities and see if that's something we can include.
The original EIS for the interim trail identified, I think, 16 stream crossings. Of some of them noteworthy, like Ebright, and some just little, you know, dinky things that ran under the trail. And it seems to me that all of those should be looked at to see what we could be doing as a major project to correct a problem while the trail work is being done.
Well, we will look at it. We talked about this previously also. We'll continue to work with the King County, but I want... Yes, the trail is being paved, and it would be nice to do it, but it is for good side of this, or the positive side of this, trail is not like a roadway that the cutting the pavement is like you're stopping the traffic, and it's a, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars cost. Clearly, if we can save it even dollar, we want to do that, and we want to work with them. But there may be some grant opportunities that the timing of these two projects may not coincide. So we'll take a look at it. We'll come back to the council, give the report on this thing.
Thank you.
Nancy, further on that, I've had some discussions with Kathy Lubert about this exact issue, working on the political side as opposed to the administrative side. And she's in agreement. Dow Constantine will be out for the Fry release that Eric mentioned a few minutes ago. We'll work on him then as well. And obviously in between now and then. We have identified, I think, within the city limits, in addition to Ebright Creek, Zacuse, Pine Lake, which is not quite in the city limits, but Zacuse is another one that fits the bill here in terms of being a restoration candidate. These are all on the radar of the Kokanee work group. So
good. Thank you.
Now, are we ready to move on to monitoring?
Yes.
Okay.
I had a question, though. Mm-hmm. Can I address this? Are we past the point where you got to the David Evans and Associate Memorandum dated December 5th? Are we moving beyond that?
We were going to move beyond that.
I'd like to pause for a second and have a question related to that. I read everything that was in this report and was quite lengthy, quite interesting. Is it Mr. Pereira? Is that how you pronounce his name?
Yes. Yes.
How much
Correa.
Money? Thank you.
I spoke.
You got to roll the tongue when you say it, I guess.
But he doesn't do it.
I understood that he contributed some of his own personal funds.
Yes.
How much was that?
I don't know for sure. The receipt that I received just covering the culvert installation was in excess of $50,000. I believe that he spent in the six figures in doing the work on his property.
He definitely deserves a commendation from the city for doing that, because of all the things that could have been done on this creek, that was the one bottleneck that seemed to be the most important to address. So on my behalf, and I don't know if the other council members agree, you know, that's an act that's Sammy-worthy, in my opinion. I don't know if he was nominated, but...
Actually, the thought has occurred, John.
Okay.
The, Eric, the number is closer to 175,000.
Wow.
And this is out of his own pocket, and something he wanted to do. He has the capability of doing it. It's in conjunction with a restoration of a property he owns, on a building he owns on the property. And he's been very interested in and very supportive of the Kokanee Work Group.
And I'm sympathetic to the fact that we have multiple streams, and some of which aren't discussed in this report, and some may have low-hanging fruit, like this bridge that, or culvert that was installed, as opposed to a pipe that would allow the Kokanee to go farther upstream to spawn. My question was on this David Evans report. However, when you start dealing with roadways and trails and 14-foot box culverts, which you indicated is more, looks more like a bridge than a culvert, you know, we're talking about probably some significant dollars. There is no price tag associated with that on this report, and it alluded in previous pages that the bottlenecks primarily had been removed, and it might cause some ease of the fish getting upstream, but it wasn't necessarily inhibiting them at this point, and there wasn't really any quantifiable numbers as to how much extra fish would go through Ebright Creek if all this work that's on the wish list was ever done. Do we have any price tags on what we're talking about? Whether it's grant money or not, it's still taxpayer money.
I don't have a... I've got a number that we kind of have been bouncing around. There, I couldn't find a parallel project. The number we think to cross the parkway is in the order of $500,000. You're right about priorities, and that is why, you know, we in the Kokanee Work Group, I know that discussions occurred where the question was asked to the biologist, what would you do if, what would be the first thing that you would do? And I remember him saying that he would make sure that Ebright was tuned up, because, I mean, it's already shown to be a producer.
Mm-hmm.
So that we can maximize the production value. And I will say, and Mr. Pereira, it was awesome. I was, the biologist said that, you know, before last year, even a couple years ago, we had a large run, but we had 1,000 fish that were trying to, just from the culvert, there was a blockage down to the lake, which was less than half a mile. You got 1,000 fish looking for a home. And obviously, we're limited. Two-thirds, he estimated this year, two-thirds of the spawning actually occurred above the culvert. So they got up there in a lot of good habitat, and I think that's great, actually. And so we will continue to evaluate those priorities. And we've been attempting, by keeping in communication with the guy who did his master's on Kokanee, you know, what should we be doing? Where are we going to get the biggest bang for it?
And I really appreciate the fact that we have this kind of volunteer-driven work group that's spending time and resources on their own accord, which we probably aren't tallying at this point, but to just suggest that we look at some of that other low-hanging fruit, and I imagine that our grant that this entity you said holds our money isn't an infinite pile, so if we're going to spend that money down, just to spend it as wisely as we can before we are dipping into city coffers again.
And we could have been more clear earlier on the way I listed those projects were kind of the, you know, the low-hanging fruit we think is invasive removals. And then after that, expanding the floodplain, because both were improving habitat, both of those activities. And then the last thing we said were the culverts. And so it's kind of like, you know, low-hanging fruit, and then, boy, if we want to try to tackle that, that's going to be a bigger effort.
Okay. I just remembered a bridge on the parkway cost us about $1 million, even though it was, what was it, stimulus money from the federal government? It still was $1 million. I didn't know what the price tag on that was going to be, okay. So thank you.
I think, John, to be fair to Eric, his work on this is just beginning. It'd be nice to have the price tag, and I was looking for the same information you were looking for when I read this too. And I know that's not there. And the reason is that Eric's a busy guy, and this is just one of the things he has to deal with. But it's also an issue which does bear more work, and I'm hopeful that in the next couple of months he'll be able to flesh this out for us. Because I frankly would, if we're going to go after any kind of grant money for this, we have to know the cost of the project.
Yeah, and how many fish you're helping.
Well, yeah.
I mean,
the what it has done though is expand the amount of spawning area by a factor of three.
Oh yeah, I mean zero to whatever it is today is a huge improvement. Yeah, so.
And but there are other places around where perhaps it might be more effective to put money in, say, in the fields or in Pine Lake.
I'm just glad to know other people are looking at those options. Thank you.
Okay. Eric, can we move on to a monitoring question?
So real quickly, I've only got a couple slides on this. I wanted to talk to you about the public monitoring that's occurring in the Ebrike Basin, the wetland that's right below City Hall, Wetland 61. We have been monitoring the water surface elevations and fluctuations on a yearly basis on that wetland. We are also taking flow and temperature data on Pereira, on Mr. Pereira's property down lower Ebrike Creek. Right next to our gauge down there is a private gauge that's being paid for, my understanding, with Friends of Pine Lake. And they are monitoring or have monitored in the past pH, turbidity, and conductivity. And I'm going to touch a little bit on that. I did want to point out that we have two developments that, per their plat conditions, when we take them over, after their maintenance and defect period, we have to develop and implement a monitoring plan for both the crossings at Pine Lake, that big development right there on Southeast 20th and 212th, and Chestnut Lane, which I think is Southeast 14th, no, Southeast 8th and 212th. It is spelled out in the plat conditions that we have to monitor for flow leaving the sites, temperature of the water leaving the sites, the turbidity of the water leaving the site, wetland hydrology on the site and off the site, and then it has some general language about assessing the stream habitat below these developments. Now, in the basin right now, these are the two of the biggest and newest developments. What I would point out that if I back up a little bit and talk a little bit about pH and turbidity and conductivity, it is, we considered the value of that data. We made some phone calls to other agencies and asked about, you know, their monitoring efforts. I spoke to the person at King County who was in charge of millions of dollars in monitoring a year in King County, and I asked him if he has done any pH monitoring on a constant basis, essentially continuous, and he said that that's expensive, and they don't think that the value is there. So they go out, and if they think pH is a concern in an area, they go out and they get grab samples on a monthly basis or maybe even a weekly basis. But it's not something they can monitor continuously without a lot of, and I think that Friends of Pine Lake would attest to this, a lot of cost to maintenance and calibration and upkeep on those. Speaking about turbidity, the sources of turbidity at the mouth would be, and we've seen this, naturally occurring slides in the ravine, and we also had the slide that was next to the residence, and those were two of our biggest turbidity events that we had. Turbidity as it relates to construction, the plats already have a responsibility to monitor turbidity leaving their site. And so while Friends, and I don't want to speak for Friends of Pine Lake, but while a group that may be concerned with the impacts of development would see value in monitoring turbidity to as a almost a watchdog, you know, we feel that we're monitoring turbidity leaving the site, which is, you know, closer to the source. And we will be monitoring that in the future because of the plat conditions. I will point out that the Platts identified the homeowners associations as being responsible for defraying the cost of this monitoring. So we are going to develop a monitoring plan. We've already started. We're going to finalize that plan. And then we're going to work with the homeowners associations on establishing that funding mechanism. I imagine that, you know, there may be some surprise in some of the residents that they will be responsible for what will likely cost thousands of dollars a year to pay for.
So in summary, that we feel that we can actually get the biggest return by doing different things than the just simply measuring or duplicating the work efforts on the measurement of the turbidity that was being suggested to us. It's a good suggestion, no question about it. It's suggested with the good intentions, but given the resources that they limited, and with the strategic investments and the expenditures that the city had incurred, we're working with the groups, that has yielded some results that we share some of the results. So that's where we are on this one.
Anybody want to comment on that before I do? John?
I may be the only one that's not a hydrologist in this room, but I didn't know what turbidity meant, but it's the cloudiness or haziness of a fluid caused by individual particles. That's so correct. For anybody at home that questioned that, maybe I was the only one. Then
you're not the only one, John.
Okay.
That didn't take thermal fluids?
I didn't.
Nancy?
This impacts a request we have from Friends of the Pine Lake to for the city to pick up the costs. I noticed two of the representatives are here. Could we have them just reiterate the reasons for that request and the benefits of this monitoring?
As a public comment to the subject?
Yeah, well, I'll permit it.
So,
Erica, do you or Eileen want to comment? And please keep
Erica
it Tilly concise.
Erica Tiliakos, Friends of Pine Lake. Yes, we've been talking to the fisheries people, and part of the reasons for doing the monitoring for pH and for turbidity is to continue to look at the stream conditions as it relates to fish and the stream health for the fish. The other reason is that the city, although they are going to be taking it over when Chestnut Lane and Crossings at Pine Lake are going to take over or deed it over to the city, the hearing examiner had required that, and I'll quote you from his findings, the applicants should be required to obtain as much baseline information as possible prior to construction and then to monitor afterwards to assure that the hydrologic status quo is maintained. So the truth is that they haven't really established even baseline monitoring, which is why Friends of Pine Lake has been doing monitoring in the stream since 1999. It is costly, but the city, when did the city take over the flow and temperature? Because that was just about a year and a half or 2 years ago. So we were covering all of the monitoring until the city decided to take over flow and temperature, but then decided that the others were too expensive to take over. So we just feel that if we're going to be doing the monitoring and we have a good baseline monitoring, that it should be complete. And the success that we're having with the kokanee returns this year, we have to try to continue to duplicate that. And we shouldn't lose a window and a picture because we're not willing to do that kind of monitoring. So that's the reason.
Thank you. Mr. City Manager, how much money are we talking about here?
Mr. Mayor, I haven't made an estimate. I guess the first question I ask my staff is that the expert in this field is that the value and the return that we get with these activities. Clearly, the first suggestion that Erica and her folks made about the taking over the temperature And then the monitoring, right, we do it on the Sammamish Commons. That was useful, and that was needed information, so we took it over this one. So I didn't take it to the next step in terms of getting some precise estimates, especially given that we have a private developers required to provide some of these estimates in the very near future. But if the council collectively is asking us to get some sort of a data on this thing, that we will squeeze it in and then get that information. I don't have that precise information tonight. I may have a range. Maybe that's what Laura is coming forward there.
We do believe that it will be probably in excess of $10,000 and include...
How much money?
$10,000, and it will include potentially weekly visits to the site. This isn't something that's done automatic.
$10,000 per year?
What's the actual range?
I think that's a fair estimate, actually. When we contracted with with Geotivity in the past, we had it was that contract was $14,000 a year for one and a half sites, essentially. And so I think $10,000 a year is a decent number to go off of.
But that's, again, I don't have a specific proposal. We're just playing guesstimate on the spot tonight, so if that's what you want, we'll try to get some information on that also.
Romero?
Are the developers going to be required to get a baseline data that's being discussed here? Is that part of their requirement? I know they're going to be monitoring, but will they be required to establish that baseline?
I'll have Eric respond to the question.
Yes, we actually have three annual reports that were generated by Crossings at Pine Lake. They looked at the wetland flow and hydrologic function for 3 years during the 3 years of the heaviest construction. And they did it, I don't know when they started, but like the plat said, as early as they could. But I do know that I have at least 3 years of reports where they looked at...
What's the information from Friends of Pine Lakes that you'll be able to add to that to go forward? Because I think it's important that we do have a baseline. I think it's also apt that given we're going to be talking here shortly about the environmental critical areas, that looking at those baselines, we can then see how things are working and if we can loosen regulations or tighten regulations as we go forward. So it's important to have those baselines.
Mr. Curley.
Are we replicating the work that's being done by the developer? The developer isn't doing water temperature. They need to expand their analysis, or are we doing the same thing they're doing?
The developer currently, when they are excavating on the site, they have to monitor for turbidity leaving the site.
Right.
I think that Chestnut Lane still has an open permit. I believe that the permit for Crossings has been closed because the main construction for the roads and stuff is complete. The taking over of that will be us, and we'll be contracting and then having the homeowners reimburse the city for the cost.
I got it. Good. So you're just trying to get a baseline now so that you can judge to see what's being done prior to afterwards, after things get going on this.
When you said are you speaking to the Friends of Pine Lake, or are...
Who's ever getting the numbers so that you have the data so that you can see future changes, you can judge by what you have right now. And that's, whether it's being done by the citizens or being done by the developer, either way, you've got some good data you're going to work with, and eventually we take the whole thing over.
And then the Homeowners Association would pay for it at that time.
Okay, good. That's all. Thanks.
Okay. I'm going to go out and let him hear and give a personal opinion.
I just give you a sense of the cost from our perspective.
Very quickly.
I just wanted to say that for 2012, we spent $3,000, a little bit less, for temperature, turbidity, conductivity. We also monitor for flow and temp in case. But so all those five parameters, we spent less than $3,000.
Okay, thank you.
That's per year, Eileen?
Yes.
And I would just take this opportunity to point out that when a city does something, I do know that I talked with the scientist who's doing the monitoring, and that Eileen has been gracious enough to do weekly visits so that they don't have to pay to have the contractor go out there and do that. But if we take it over, my guess is, well, I know that
it's going to be staff time. That's why I don't have estimates. I don't want to give you numbers. We need to give you the true estimates. I don't have that number tonight.
I think we need to get a better handle on that particular issue. However, we just spent the last 40 minutes talking about Ebrite Creek and the fish issue down there, and also the fact that one of our residents has contributed a sizable amount of cash out of his own pocket to fixing a problem. And this is the other aspect of it. Frankly, all the conditions we're talking about here are important to the success of the kokanee hatchery in that stream. Because if the water condition falls off, all the money we'd be spending on anything else is probably for naught. In addition, I have severe reservations, frankly, about how effective we are at enforcing the requirements with a contractor or an HOA in the long term. So I think we need to come back for further discussion of this issue, Mr. City Manager.
We'll do that, and I'll work with the Mayor, Deputy Mayor, to schedule it probably, I don't know when, we'll figure it out sometime.
Yes, sir.
Clearly, you got other items that you put on the budget, yes. So we're working on it.
Nancy?
This is something that's been before us for, I think, probably at least several requests over a period of years. So I really would like to see it. I know you need some time to do it, but sooner than later, and not let it go by for another whatever. We're basking in the supposed success of this salmon kokanee project. Mm-hmm. Let's support it and make sure we guarantee or assure to the extent we can whatever, and look into the issues and the concerns, and then make our decision as conveniently possible.
Well, let me clarify one thing. I think that what we heard from our in-house expert is that that we're not denying that information is going to be provided in terms of to getting the returns for the investment we're making it. That's what the priority that you need to make. And we'll get that information that the council decide which way you want to go with us.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on. The next subject on our agenda is, in fact, the Environmental Critical Areas Ordinance and the handoff from the Planning Commission. So, Mr. City Manager, do you want to introduce us?
Mr. Mayor, thank you. And tonight we have our Planning Commission Chair and Vice Chair to present you the year-long of hard work and effort that they put into this Environmentally Critical Areas Ordinance update. Before I turn it over to them, I personally want to thank them. Both chair and vice chair and the rest of the commissioners. These folks are volunteers. They're dedicated hundreds, if not thousands of hours collectively to get this document and recommendation to you. You may not agree with everything that they presented to you. As a matter of fact, you already heard some testimonies that the folks that they don't necessarily agree with what they're presenting to you. And you're going to find the folks on the both sides of the aisle. I want you to also consider that when everybody is not necessarily agreeing with that, I think that they came up with the consensus and came up with some resolution to some of the issues. They heard a lot. They funneled the recommendations. Tonight, we have the Kath Richardson here, the chair of the commission, is going to present us the Planning Commission's recommendations.
Yes, good evening.
Just hang on a second, Kathy.
Sure.
First of all, I'd like to welcome both Kathy and Mike Luxemburg, who the mayor and deputy mayor have gotten to know very well over the past year plus talking about this whole process. So tonight we're here at the culmination of your long and very hard and strenuous efforts here. We also have, thank you. We also have another planning commissioner, Mabubul Islam, in the audience, who is showing an awful lot of interest in this, as have all the others. The handoff tonight marks the end of your work on this, at the beginning of the City Council's efforts at taking this over from you. And as the City Manager just mentioned, we're going from a very wide open funnel that took in an awful lot of stuff, and you guys have been charged with narrowing it down to make it manageable for us, and we thank you for all the effort you put into this. I know it's taken an awful lot of time. Tonight, our job is to listen to your presentation, to understand the process that you went through and the rationale for your decision-making. We will ask questions as a council for clarification where they're needed. We will have our own time for deliberation and debate later on in this process, not tonight. We're scheduling follow-up meetings in March for council members to talk to staff on the issues. Our public hearings and deliberations are likely to be held in April and May of this year. And our goal here is to not repeat all the work of the Planning Commission. That was something we stressed very strongly with Kathy and Mike in our on our regular meetings, and we're confident that the process they've set up is key to helping us do this. The final adoption of this whole effort in terms of enabling legislation, if you will, is we're hopefully getting it done sometime in June before we have the sunset deadline for the CAO. So having said that, just to get some points on the record here, Kathy, I'm going to turn it over to you and let you do your thing here.
Thank you. So I'm Kathy Richardson. I'm the chair of the Planning Commission. I want to, before I get into the presentation, actually take a few moments to thank some key participants in the process so that I don't forget to do that and so that you all remember. The degree of participation that we were fortunate to have in our process. I'd actually like to start by thanking the citizen representation that we had throughout our process. The testimony that we received was thoughtful, it was thorough, it was clearly and fairly presented, and I really want to thank everyone for sharing their points of view and the information that they had gathered and helping us try to make the best recommendation that we could to you as part of our handoff. I also want to thank staff for guiding and informing our process. I do want to give Evan Maxson some special recognition. He managed this project throughout and also did a lion's share of the work. So I wanted to thank Evan personally for his efforts in that regard. I also want to thank the commission and again recognize Commissioner Luxemburg and Commissioner Islam who are here tonight. I think that represents the dedication that the commission had throughout this process. They were highly committed to achieving our success factors, and which you will see as part of this presentation. And I want to thank them and recognize them for the time and effort that was required to make a thoughtful and informed recommendation to council tonight. Tonight, I'm going to actually focus most of my presentation on our review process. There were kind of three key tenets to this review process. They are a thorough fact-finding and analysis period, an inclusive public process, and a well-documented set of recommendations. After I'm done walking through our process, I want to highlight a few of the areas that received a substantial amount of input and Planning Commission time because I suspect those are recommendations that will also require some thorough discovery and consideration on the Council's part as well. Mm-hmm. So this slide is the same slide with a few minor additions that we presented to Council back in May of 2012. This is an overview of the review process. I'm not going to go through this in grave detail, but I think you can start to get a sense of some of the levels of detail that we went as part of our process. I am going to actually break this up into some key components and walk through them individually. So the first aspect that I want to focus on is fact-finding and analysis. We, as a commission, received a set of known topics from the council. We used that known topics document to define the scope of our review. The there were some things that came up throughout our process that were not within that scope, and those actually ended up on what we call the parking lot. And I believe those parking lot items were provided to you in a memo that was part of your packet tonight. The second kind of area of input that we received were the best available science reports from the consultant. And then the third, and along with that, the staff's assistance in interpreting and understanding those best available science reports. The third kind of key area of input that we had was the substantial amount of public input that we had throughout our process. Those three aspects of input were consolidated into a set of items for further consideration. I believe when we started this process, kind of the large end of the funnel had over 70 recommendations for us to consider. In order to manage all of those recommendations, we prioritized them based on the information that we were gathering throughout our discovery into what we called major items, minor items, and, as I discussed, parking lot. There is a memo that the transmittal memo describes, I think, in some detail kind of how we categorize the major and minor items. If you have questions about that, we can get to that at the end of the presentation. But the major items actually were then, they were deemed by the commission to be of significant importance or complexity to actually go through a further level of analysis and fact-finding. Throughout all of this, there were two kind of guiding principle type documents that we used. One is our success statement and the other is our ground rules, and I believe those have also been provided to you as part of our packet. So a couple of additional comments around this kind of information gathering end of the funnel. We did, again, focus on the known topics. The best available science reports were quite thorough and detailed, and many of us spent many hours looking up terms that we weren't familiar with. And there were actually multiple methods for providing public comments, and I'll talk about that a little bit more relative to the inclusive process. I think one of the other kind of guiding principles that we used was to really focus on the facts. I don't think actually there was much true dissension around what the facts were. Even if you had different points of view about the level of risk that we should take or about what change we should or should not consider, there was a general consensus, I think, around what the facts were. I think the challenge is what do you do with the facts that you have, and there were probably lots of aspects where we would have liked to have a few more facts than we did. From an inclusive process perspective, there was quite a substantial amount of public outreach. There was a postcard mailing that went to all citizens. There were Gov alerts that went out pretty regularly. There were, I think, a couple of articles in the newsletter that's put out by the city. All of this outreach ended up in quite a bit of public participation. We did have more than 25 Planning Commission meetings. All of those meetings, with the exception of the deliberations, had an opportunity for public comment. We received 165 verbal comments and 280 written comments, which are either summarized or published in their original form on the website. I would also point out that there was an opportunity. We had several open houses after each set of topics where the public, the commission, staff, and the consultants had an opportunity to interact with each other in an informal way, ask questions, perhaps pursue lines of thinking. I wanted to note for the record that there was definitely several different opportunities for dialogue amongst those groups. We definitely received a variety of opinions throughout that inclusive process. There was definitely strong advocacy for adequate protection of the environment. There was also strong advocacy for increased flexibility for property owners while still retaining those protective measures for the environment. We also did receive input from several public agencies on key issues where they provide that kind of input. The evaluation forms was one of the items where we spent most, I would say a good portion of our time. I think most might be an overstatement. These were the tools that we used to guide our decision-making process around the major items.
We established a set of rating criteria, which I'll show you in a minute. That rating criteria was applied to each recommendation. That each recommendation then was discussed and an evaluation form finalized by the Planning Commission. If the Planning Commission version of the evaluation form resulted in an overall negative effect, that alternative had kind of two possible paths. One was to not move further in the process, and we did have some that did stop at that point, or we had an opportunity to continue to work with the advocate for that particular recommendation to try to come up with an alternative to that recommendation that resulted in an overall positive. And we'll go through this in a little bit more detail. So this is an example of the evaluation form, and I believe these are in the materials that will be provided to you. The first page provides a summary of the recommendation. There's a section that provides the existing or current regulation. There's a section that describes the proposed amendment. And then there's a section that describes the result that is intended for that proposed amendment. There's also a substantial amount of reference information. So there would be where the source, where the amendment was originally advocated, whether it was a best available science report or public input or from another agency. Any best available science support for a particular recommendation. So that might refer back to the consultant best available science report as an example. Any relevant information that's related, so studies that were provided in our materials, maybe references to code, either WAC or existing Sammamish code that might be useful in us better understanding both the recommendation and the implications. And then the public comment references. So in this example, you probably can't see it very well, there are four public comment references. And these public comments could both be for or against the particular recommendation. So this provided the Planning Commission with a very nice summary of all of the related information for a particular recommendation. The second page of the form is the evaluation itself. And there are three aspects that we evaluated each recommendation for the impact on those aspects, for lack of a better term. The first is the environmental aspect. The second is the implementation effect aspect, and this would be around administrative or agency typically implications. And the third would be the property effect. This would be, you know, positive or negative from a developer perspective versus positive or negative for implementation or administering a particular change. And then we also looked at whether or not there was a net benefit to the environment. These three aspects were then discussed individually by the Planning Commission. And the criteria for each aspect was applied to come up with the overall rating, okay? Then, after each of the three aspects were discussed and an individual rating for each aspect was determined, then the overall effect was determined. So the three aspects all influence the overall effect. These are the rating criteria that we used. We used the same rating criteria for every recommendation. And there's a couple of comments I want to make at this point. The first is, even though we used the same rating criteria, we did provide a large positive, large negative, small positive, small negative, or neutral rating to each of the effects. So you might have agreement around an increase to a positive thing or an increase to a negative thing, but whether or not that was a large increase or a small increase was where we had some discussion as a commission. And so I want to highlight that to the council, that we all had the same set of facts, we all had good discussion around the impact based on the criteria, but there is a qualitative assessment that's included in this large positive, large negative, small negative. And that can and did influence the overall rating for some of these items. The other thing that I want to point out, and I think you've heard some testimony to this effect, is this process that we implemented did have an underlying assumption that the current code was the baseline against which we were making these assessments, okay? So if the current code was incorrect in the first place, this form would not necessarily result in the in a recommendation to change that. So let me give you an example. Let's say that, trying to think of a good example. Let's say that we'll use this, there's been a comment about the streams buffers being too large, and that was perhaps the reason why the sunset clause was originally added to the code. So there's two things that happened in our review. One was we had a best available science report around stream buffers that did not bring us to the conclusion that the stream buffers that we had in our current code were overly large. Okay? So there was not a best available science conclusion that brought us to our buffers are too big. And if we had a recommendation that said the buffers are too big, therefore you should make them smaller, the assessment would be, in order to make the buffer smaller, you have to offset that with something. Because the assumption is that the buffer is the starting point. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay. So I just want to, that's been some of the testimony that you've heard, and I want to highlight that this was, I think, a very useful process for us to go through, and there are some assumptions that were built into the process. The other assumption that was built into the process is that we should treat each of the aspects equally. Okay, that we wouldn't, going into an assessment, weigh one aspect differently than another aspect, because we wanted to use this tool to help us achieve balance. However, and I'm going to go to the second bullet here, we did feel that a large negative impact in any aspect or two small negative impacts in any aspect would result in an overall negative effect. So even though we didn't weigh one over the other, we did ensure that no overall negative impact that was high would result in a change to our code, okay? And again, you can debate whether or not that was the right decision, but I want to be clear about how we came up with the ratings that guided our recommendations. The other point that I want to make is any recommendation that resulted in an overall negative is not reflected in our final recommendation to council. So in order to proceed to deliberations, a recommendation had to result in a positive impact above where the code is today, which is a very high standard. I'm going to pause for a minute and ask if there are any questions, because this is really kind of an important aspect of our process and our decision making.
Anyone have questions? I have a couple. Were you guys generally unified on the process itself?
Yes.
And on the rating criteria?
Yes.
Unanimously, so, or was there any dissension?
Actually, there wasn't any dissension when we proposed the process. So the way that we went about introducing this to the Planning Commission is we provided an example form, and we provided, can I go backwards? No, that's forward. So as an example, we presented the commission with the rating criteria. And actually, these slides are from the staff presentation to the commission from our meeting. And the commission had a conversation about whether or not these were the rating criteria that we wanted to apply. We made any modifications that we felt were appropriate, and then we adopted this as our rating criteria, as an example. The same thing with how the individual ratings would be discussed and how they would influence the overall rating, as well as the form itself. We actually spent, I think, a good portion of a meeting. I'm going to try to go backwards again. Nope. This mouse seems to be upside down. Thank you. We did also review the form, and there were some changes, actually, that were made to the form based on the commission's input. So the form and the form itself and the process for utilizing the form was reviewed in quite detail with the commission before we actually implemented it. And I think in hindsight, we all believe this was a very effective tool. I think that no tool is perfect and no process is perfect. And so I've tried to highlight for you some of the feedback that we've received from the public and the commission about the process and the tools so that you are aware of some of the perceived imperfections. I believe that this provided us with a tool to have the facts at our fingertips and to have a conversation and a dialogue about the relative weight of some of those criteria. And I also am, like I said, I think we had a very high standard for the changes that we actually would include in our recommendations, that we had to achieve a positive change over the existing code before it would proceed.
Okay, thank you. Oh, Nancy?
Commissioner Islam wrote in his dissent that he says there's no statutory basis in the state GMA or any other relevant federal, state, or local law to support the rating mechanism, which would consider code amendments to protect ECA values and functions only if they're deemed economically feasible and easily implementable.
So I think that we used both the guidance that we received from the statutes themselves, from staff, and from our own, our own code. So we tried very hard to balance both the environment and development. Comprehensive plan, thank you, that's what I was looking. We were looking to the comprehensive plan of our city, actually, to provide us with some guidance around that as well. And I think Commissioner Islam would advocate for a weighted rating to give more weight to the environmental effect than the other three. I think that's essentially, I hope I am speaking for him correctly, but that is not the that was not the decision that we made as a commission. We decided as a commission to treat them all equally, but to ensure that no large negative impact to any of the three would proceed.
Okay. Real.
Kathy, Michael, thank you again for the work that you've done. Going back to your rating slide, which I believe is it one back?
The back?
Yes.
Nope.
Keep going. I just want to get a clarification on that. On the environmental effects, for example, you have cited as the positive and the negative, the net loss of function and value, and also the benefits of improved functions and values. Given what you had said earlier about assumptions, I just want to be clear on this. Was there any actual measuring of baselines as you made these recommendations on how the existing regulations are impacting either favorably or unfavorably to these steep soils, wetlands, et cetera, so that the mitigations could be taken?
We did rely on the consultant reports to provide us with some of that information. An example might be one of the reports that we received around landslide hazard areas referenced a City of Seattle report around landslides in steep slopes that weren't very high, as an example. And then we relied on staff to provide us input on whether or not the city itself had experienced a similar kind of impact. And so we had both the consultant reports that were not necessarily city-specific, and then we relied on staff. And we had public input as well around the local impacts of the regulations themselves.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. John, did you have a question?
I think it was answered.
Okay, anyone else? Okay.
Okay.
Thank
so.
You.
No, she's still moving. This is just taking her breath.
I want to talk briefly about our deliberation. Again, only the overall positive items were considered for changes to the code. There were several minor items, and even though we focused a lot of time and effort on the major items, I want to kind of emphasize that the minor items were actually also very important. I think that they were things, though, that were recommendations that were quite clear in what they were proposing and had good substantiation for the recommendations and didn't require kind of substantial further discussion from the commission. And the way that we separated major and minor was based on input from the commission. The commissioners actually provided myself and the vice chair with a list of the things that they thought needed further discussion before they were comfortable making a decision on whether or not the change would be implemented. There was substantial public input, also input from the public hearings, and we had the draft code as input to our deliberations as well. Our deliberation process was a two-phase commit, so to speak. The first phase was for the major items to take a vote on the policy item itself, okay? And so that was based on the recommendation of the evaluation form. We had some brief discussion, since we'd obviously already spoken, had lots of discussion about each form previously. And then there was a vote taken on the policy item itself. Some of the policy items did not receive a passing vote. And you can see in your materials some examples. I think there may be two or three. If a policy item received a passing vote, then we looked at the specific changes to the code. I think in a couple of cases, some amendments were proposed to the changes reflected in the code, and then a vote was taken on the code. So, like I said, it was a two-phase commit. Those items that we did not approve from a policy perspective, we didn't need to look at the code because the code changes would not be implemented. The outcome of that deliberation process is a set of recommendations, minority reports, code, and lots of documentation, which we are handing off to you in our transmittal package. We have 51 recommended amendments that were approved by the commission. 8 of them were major items, 43 were minor items. More than 90% of the amendments were based on best available science. And we've prepared a memo for you regarding the items that were not best available science based, that were policy based, for your review. And we can have some further discussions about that after you've had a chance to read that. I'm going to transition to a couple of the key recommendations that we've included for your consideration. The items that generated the most public comment were allowances for existing development, wetland development flexibilities, and development in the no disturbance area, also known as the overlay. So regarding allowances for existing development, this was one of the known topics. We did have substantial public input that also prompted our review. The recommendation mirrors the approach that's used in the Shoreline Master Program to a great degree. You did receive some testimony tonight, I think, indicating that perhaps not all of the flexibilities that were proposed are included in our final recommendation. One of the things that we did include was a flexibility within the shadow of an existing building. So where there's a building that is between an area that is to be developed and a critical area, we have added the flexibility to develop within the shadow of that building. There is mitigation required so that you're actually enhancing the buffer as a result of the development. But that is an additional flexibility that's not in the code today. We did, I think, substantial work around clarifying the existing flexibilities and exemptions, being much more clear about what is allowed and not allowed, in particular under a pre-developed condition. Those weren't actually changes, material changes. They were simply improvements for clarity. And then we changed the timeline to rebuild to mirror the same language that's in the SMP. So in essence, there was a 12-month period to rebuild an existing legally built development in the current ECA. The SMP expanded that to 24 months, I think with an opportunity for a little bit more than that. The thinking behind that is when you are rebuilding in on a piece of property that has a critical area, sometimes it takes a little bit more time to finalize your plans and implement them in a way that's acceptable to all parties. So we wanted to make a similar allowance in the ECA as is already in the SMP. And that is actually also provides for some consistency between the two, which I know is something that the council was looking for. The second item that received quite a bit of public input and is also a known topic was wetland development flexibilities. In particular, the recommendations from the Planning Commission include an increase to the amount of impact allowed for isolated wetlands with low habitat value. I think the thinking behind this is there's water quality value with these isolated wetlands, but not a particular habitat value as determined by the wetland rating score that's required when you go through a development process for one of these critical areas. So we expanded the area that you are allowed to fill or impact. Fill would be the, I think, most substantial impact, but there are lower impacts that you would also be allowed to do. We also increased the size of the wetland that you could impact from 1,000 square feet to 4,000 square feet. And again, mitigation would be required for these impacts. So that is a way to offset the environmental impact, is to provide mitigation. There was also a reduced buffer of 15 feet for small, low-value wetlands. And again, the thinking is that the buffer is really for water quality primarily, not necessarily for habitat value. The final item that I want to introduce to you tonight.
Kathy, yes. Hang on, we've got a question here.
Oh, you're going to make me go back.
What is a small wetland? How big?
How big is a small wetland? I believe it's 4,000 square feet. Evan, can you make me honest here? I will allow staff to answer that question.
Thank you, Commissioner. Pardon me, City Council, Mayor, City Manager. I'm Evan Maxim, one of the senior planners for the City of Sammamish. I apologize, I'm losing my voice a little bit, so if I'm soft, I'm sorry for that.
You've had a rough couple of days.
Bear with me for one moment while I get the specific answer to that question.
Do you not know the entire code book about the 500 page on top of your head with this line item?
Sadly, sir, I'm getting a little tired today. Bear with me for just one moment, though, and I can't answer that question.
You want to continue?
No, I was just calling.
I have the answer now, City Manager. That would actually be for a total area of 4,000 square feet. So we do have that upper limit in place.
Before you run off, Evan, I've got a question on how is habitat value determined? Maybe it's yet to come in this whole discussion, but as long as we're there.
Thank you, Mayor. It is not a short answer. Let me preface it with that way. There is essentially a set of state documents that dictate how habitat scores are measured in Western Washington. And I think this might be an item that we could get into in our study session. It is standardized across the state, and it involves a fair bit of training for biologists to accurately score this type of wetland.
Okay. There are criteria laid out, is my point, I guess, right?
Yes, and I can't provide those to the council.
Okay, I'll be happy to wait for a more extended discussion, so thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Any other questions before I move on? Okay. The last item that I wanted to introduce tonight is development in the no disturbance area. This, again, was a known topic, which had substantial public input. Our recommendations include an allowance for single-family homes to expand with no increase to surface water discharge volume. This is an impervious surface expansion. Thinking is that as long as no additional volume runs off the site, that really is the thing that we were most concerned with, and that this would be a reasonable flexibility to allow. The second is a pilot program approach to subdivision. There were several alternatives that were considered by the commission before concluding with a final set of recommendations. And I think the primary reason for that is we were working very hard to achieve a positive overall impact. And frankly, I do believe that this discussion comes down to a discussion of risk that the council needs to consider. Currently, you are not allowed to subdivide in this area, okay? So we are recommending that prohibition be removed and replaced with a pilot program. I think this is consistent with GMA guidelines when you're not quite sure what the impact will be, that you take it slow and you monitor. And so we have recommended, I think, a very comprehensive pilot program that includes very tight control during construction. Primary concern, I believe, this is my understanding, so forgive me if it's not completely accurate, is erosion during the construction period. Now, we focused our pilot program on not just during the construction period, but in general stormwater management of these sites, because we wanted to, again, minimize any risk to Lake Sammamish of increased development in this area. So again, there's very tight control during construction. You'll see this in our recommendation. And there's substantial monitoring and reporting requirements to assess the impacts of the pilot and whether or not it should be expanded or removed. The stormwater management techniques is an aspect where there are a couple of different alternatives. One is where sites have an opportunity and a capability to tight line to the lake, that's required. Not all sites in this area have that option available to them at this point in time. So there is also an armored ditch option. And again, that armored ditch option has some pretty significant constraints on flow, some constraints on volume, and also some requirements around evaluating that armored ditch and ensuring its ability to sustain the stormwater volume that it is expected to support. So these are the three recommendations that we expect to be at the small end of the funnel for council to spend some time on. There may be others as you look through the major and minor recommendations that we hand off to you, but these were definitely the ones that the Planning Commission spent a great deal of time on, and I would expect a similar experience at the council level. There were several minority reports prepared by the planning, by individual planning commissioners. One of them actually was prepared by three planning commissioners, so I'll highlight that for you. They did generally focus on the three areas that I just described. However, one of them did focus on some other recommendations as well, and you have that information available to you. Both the vice chair and myself have offered to be available to the council to provide a little bit more detail around some of these other items in your future meeting, so we don't have to cover them here tonight. There were several other major policy recommendations that were included that I don't plan to go into nearly the same detail that I did the other three. A couple to point out, fee and lieu mitigation for wetlands and streams. That's an option that was not available and we are now seeing some fee and lieu programs that we would like to have
people have an opportunity to participate in if it makes sense. An alternative to the current wildlife habitat protection and corridors. Revised wetland mitigation ratios. These are much more, I think, complicated, but also much more, I think, relevant and appropriate. So you'll see that, as well as the introduction of wetland mosaics to our considerations. Yes, Mr. Valderrama.
Go ahead.
On the fee and lieu that you mentioned on this side, both for wetlands and streams, 28B, 33B, just curious, I saw that you referenced the best available science. Are we going to be following King County standards under your recommendation, or?
So the King County program would be a program that our residents would have an opportunity to participate in. Is that what you're asking?
That's correct.
So, yes.
That's the idea of this. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. So this is our success statement, and again, this has been provided to you before. I want to highlight that I feel as though the commission actually hit every single one of these but one. And the one that I think we tried valiantly to achieve but did not in the end was the ability to meet the time frame in the council approved schedule. I think, you know, in our joint meeting there was definitely feedback from the council that we had a very large undertaking and a very aggressive schedule, and we would definitely occur with that observation. But I do believe that we have taken the time to do a quality job and to achieve the other key components of success from our perspective around fairness, transparency, fact-finding, thoroughness, clarity, etc.
Kathy, I'm going to give you a get-out-of-jail-free card on that one, because the council leadership consistently told you to get it right as opposed to get it on time. So you get a pass on that one.
Thank you. So with that, we have some time for some questions.
Are there other questions for the chair? Ramiro.
I have a question on the mosaic, wetland mosaics, and trying to find on item 37B a definition for what the wetland mosaic.
So I don't believe that we've defined it explicitly. I think it's already defined in some of the state regulations and the Department of Ecology wetland rating form. So we did not include a definition at this point in time.
Well, there's a follow-up to that, because I had seen that in one of the public comments when I was there on 220, Ecology found that there was no need to be able to present modifications since we're under state law. So what was the rationale then of bringing it to us?
I'm sorry, I'm not quite sure what your question is.
So you're using the state definition for wetlands, is that
correct? So we did not add a definition to our code. We did add the consideration of wetland mosaics as part of the critical areas study requirements, I believe.
I understand. And so I saw the letter on public comment 220 submission from the Department of Ecology, where they say, because the city is not proposing to change the way it rates wetlands within its jurisdiction, the Washington State Wetland Rating System for Western Washington already provides a method for determining whether a wetland area is part of a mosaic or is to be rated separately.
So, Romero, is this something the rest of us have access to?
Yes.
Yeah, it's a letter from the Department of Ecology. It's included in the public comment. Are you asking why is it included when the Department of Ecology suggested that it not be?
No, I'm saying that if Ecology, you just said that the definition is the same as the state, and I'm just curious why we're looking at this issue.
We did not add a definition.
Understand.
But we just added. In the critical area study section of the code, I believe we added a note that that would be an area that needed to be considered as part of the study, which is consistent with the Department of Ecology recommendation.
So we were not following the state regulations before?
That's
my question.
So I think this was more of a clarity item than a change to the code. So it was just to provide a little bit more clarity around the fact that that would be a consideration for a critical
area
study.
This would not be a policy issue for us.
No.
It would just be for a clarification that would
it
be
It was not
in
considered a policy issue.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anyone else?
I have one question.
Uh, John?
I'm looking at the dissenting memo that was prepared by Commissioner Lipinski, and I guess if I had to read the long and the short of it, he wasn't really for the recommendations of the entire council and had wished that we had just adopted the King County Stormwater Manual and would have been better off and
so
saved
believe,
a lot of time.
I believe Commissioner Lipinski is specifically referring to the overlay.
Okay.
And his, if I will try to represent his point of view was that the stormwater requirements that the city has currently, which includes the Stormwater Manual, the King County Stormwater Manual, he felt as though that was sufficient for managing the volume and flow of stormwater from development, specifically subdivisions in the overlay. He did not feel as though we needed to add all of the other requirements that are in your current recommendation, and there are several. For example, we are requiring you to tightline if you have that option available to you. I'm not sure necessarily that that would come out of the King County stormwater requirements explicitly, although I'm sure it would be one of the things that would be considered.
Okay.
I'm not a stormwater expert, but I do believe that our recommendation to you is more strict than would be required under the current stormwater guidelines for the city.
Okay.
Intentionally.
I believe John Curley has a question.
Can you walk me through a hypothetical pilot program?
Sure. I will try.
Mr. Smith, the homeowner, has a property that he'd like to sell, and it's in a no disturbance. So go ahead, take me through it.
So right now, if you want to sell it, you cannot sell it as a subdividable property because it is not.
Okay.
So you can only sell it as a single-family residence.
Got it.
In the future, if you approve our recommendation, up to 9 developments could be approved, 3 of each different type of development, and you'll see this in the code. So I'll give you an example of the tightline version. So if that property had the opportunity to tightline directly to the lake, you could subdivide it if you got into the pilot process and met all of the permit requirements associated with that. You would then be required to monitor your development, in particular during what we would call the wet season, so to speak, because when it's rainy, things have a higher opportunity to erode. You would also be required to monitor both before, during, and after construction, things like turbidity, as an example, that you've all seen previously. So there are several monitoring requirements. They primarily fall around flow and volume, and I think stuff in the water. I don't know. I'm seeing some nods from people.
Okay.
Water quality.
Okay, so then if the turbidity and some of those other things, if you then judge them to be damaging to the lake, then there's a tremendous mitigation process that must be put on top.
So the monitoring is not necessarily intended to require mitigation, and that might be something you could talk with staff about a little further. It's intended to assess whether or not there was increased risk to the lake based on the development. So let's say in that monitoring, there was quite a bit, there were some water quality issues that were found.
Okay.
Then in the report back to council, staff would say, gosh, I'm not sure that we should either change the requirement to prevent those water quality issues, or this is way too risky. The impact to the water quality is such that we would recommend that you end the pilot and not open up development beyond the pilot. They might also recommend that you end the pilot early, depending on what the implications of the monitoring show. I think what we've tried to do, though, is recommend a set of very strict requirements to ensure that we aren't impacting the lake, and what the monitoring is intended to do is to prove that we were successful in that endeavor.
I see.
I don't think that staff would have recommended any change that they felt had a high likelihood of causing a negative impact to the lake.
So there's no reason at some point halfway through the development, halfway through the construction, that you determine that the pilot program is awful for the lake. You can't suddenly stop it.
Well, so during development, there are some things that can be done. And that, just like during development anywhere else.
Okay.
Okay? And that really is, I think the biggest concern is during development, what kind of erosion would happen. So there's some very strict controls there. But there's some question about after development, would there be impacts as well? And I think we put in some monitoring requirements to enable to determine that more clearly. I see someone standing
there
that wants
I'm good.
To add.
Okay, Nancy, you have a question?
I'm sorry.
I have a lot more, but I'll save it.
And we will go into this in much more detail in future discussions.
Are
any of these three major topics that you've touched on not in accord with best available science?
I don't believe so. There's one. Yes, the wetland flexibilities is. Thank you. And I believe that's described in the memo that it was that provided in their packet tonight?
The deviation memo?
The deviation memo was provided to you in your packet
the,
tonight.
Planning director to use the mic as well.
Yeah.
Huh? Okay.
Sorry. Hi, Cameron Grohl with the Community Development Department. There are some places where the Planning Commission's recommendations deviate from best available science. The Washington Administrative Code recognizes that this may come up as a part of a local government's decision-making
process. I know that, but I'm...
And so they provide a process and recommendations for how we handle that. In your packet, the binder that's in front of you tonight is a memo that describes where those deviations have occurred and the rationale used by the commission.
Were any of the three major topics so that she's mentioned tonight within those?
Yes, at least two that come to mind. The flexibilities for small and isolated wetlands is one of them. I think you could say the recommendations for the no disturbance area probably also do that.
So it's a no risk plus a BAS discussion that we're going to be having on that one?
That's right. You will have a risk and a BAS discussion on that. That's right.
Okay. Okay. I guess my other question is, thank you very much. That helps. If we do these pilot projects and we have a worst scenario outcome, which is the big risk that nobody hopes happens, and it's too late, homes are built, are the downstream owners, like the lakefront homeowners, willing to assume responsibility by default, if nothing else, because they're kind of the last resort for helping to increase the water quality of Lake Sammamish? I mean, it seems to me the risk factor isn't just the city and how much it's going to cost to repair a road, but what can we do to clean up the mess we've made if the worst scenario comes about? And what we look to is where we can do it, and it's downstream.
I would, so I can't speak from the for the people that would be downstream from these developments. I believe that the recommendations have been written in such a way to protect the environment and our citizens. And the reason why the pilot is restricted is because it's a very large lake, and the impact of a small number of developments on a very large lake is much less than the impact of several developments on a very large lake. So part of the pilot was intended to be a small number of developments to, again, minimize the risk. And I think this is the debate. You will have it. Right now, this isn't allowed. So allowing it creates risk. And the question to the commission was, how much risk do you think is acceptable? I think the question to council will be, how much risk do you think is acceptable? Your answer personally may be none. Your answer personally may be, I don't believe there's risk. Those are the things that you're going to have to decide.
Thank you very much, Kathy. Oh, can I make one comment? I wanted to thank you very much. One of the, for the whole process, one of the things that had been so frustrating in the past with like shoreline management is we got a product from the Planning Commission, but we didn't know the reasoning underneath it. Mm-hmm. We decided because we didn't like some of the things we saw, to redo the entirety of it.
Right.
And start over. I think here you have given us a wonderful foundation for being able to follow your process, your thinking on it collectively, and how you got there and what the pros and cons are. So I'm extremely pleased with the product that we've received. I think we can work with it and go forward. So thank you very much to you and all your commissioners for their hard work.
Thank you. That was definitely one of our goals. So I'm glad that from your point of view, we've achieved it. That means a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. That's a topic that was discussed very early on with the PC leadership and was continually reemphasized.
So it's been a wonderful product in that regard.
Thank you. Yes, we don't necessarily expect you to agree with us, but we expect you to have all the information you need to make your own decisions.
Okay. I'd like to turn to the city manager now for a wrap-up.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And then I want to thank also our commissioners that they're doing a wonderful job. There's a couple comments that I'd like to make at the end. One is related to the pilot program, and then that's a comment, and then we'll get into more details later in our study sessions. Then I'm going to turn it over to our community development director to go through this binder with you. My comment related to the pilot program, as your gatekeeper here with the expenses associated, well, I very much applaud the Planning Commission's out-of-box thinking and coming up with creative ideas. It's a staff incentive program. It takes a lot of staff resources. There are two ways that we can handle that one, if that's what the council wants to handle it. One is that the city pays for the staff resources. Option number two is that typically that's what you do in any creative program, is that having the applicant who is interested in doing the pilot program also pay for the cost of the staff to implement that particular program. So, but we get into those details as we get into the discussions in the study session. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our Community Development Director and Assistant City Manager, Cameron Giral. Cameron?
Thank you very much, Ben. And I won't take too much of the Council's time, but you noticed when you sat down, you had binders like this in front of you. The members of the Council and the public all last Thursday or Friday, we published the Planning Commission's transmittal memo where we mentioned that we would be providing information to the City Council in two volumes, kind of a set of information that either came last Friday or was handed out here tonight. That's volume one. Volume two is still being compiled and put together. Volume two we're going to publish electronically on the city's website, not planning to actually put kill more trees and produce more paper with that. But everything that the commission has done is available to the council, to the public, to review. What we've tried to do, and really commend the commission for not only producing the work, but working with us in between meetings to refine and make sure that these materials accurately reflect their work. We've compiled this in a binder for council members. And I just want to take a couple minutes just to quickly walk you through what's in the binder. Some of this you've already seen. It was in the council packet for tonight. So we won't go through the handoff memo, major and minor items, etc., like that. That's all under tab one. You're familiar with that material. And I want to thank Debbie Beadle, our administrative staff assistant. She was assembling all of these up until pretty much she left today. So she manages to deal with a lot of other things while this paper flows in and out of her hands in her office. So tab two starts with some material that you've seen before and you've heard about here tonight. The Planning Commission's success statement, their evaluation forms, and overall effects documents. So these, again, reference so you can go back and look at these and make sure you understand how they came to those conclusions. The forms, I think, merit the attention of the council. If you were going to go through and really try to understand the background of both the three items that we focused on here tonight and the other major items, I'd start there because the form really captures the key information and the criteria that were used by the commission. These, again, are the forms that were approved by the commission and that were used for their decision making. Tab three contains a document that I just mentioned a moment ago in response to Councilmember Whitten's question about deviations from best available science. Councilmember Whitten, I think, correctly brought up that we are operating within a framework provided by state statute and state regulation. We have to keep those in mind as we go through this process, and if we have a decision that varies from the strict requirements of best available science, because we're balancing, we want to document why that's there. Tab 4 has the existing flexibilities that actually are in our ECA code today. I'd say the Planning Commission's recommendations expand upon those flexibilities. But sometimes we hear that, geez, the code is too rigid. Well, I think the council's been wise enough in years past to actually put in a variety of flexibilities that are already there. We're building upon that in this process. Tab 5 is the actual recommended code. And this is a great document to spend, if you can't sleep at night, get this out and start paging through it. It is done in a strike-through and underline format, so you can see what's changed. I want to note that Evan spent a lot of time working on this and making sure, again, it accurately reflected. You also see in the annotation comments off to the right and left in the margins, the little item 5-9 or item 2-8C. That's why it's that section of code that corresponds to the evaluation form that you can find back in the earlier tab. So it should help you in wayfinding through the material. Tab 6 has your comprehensive plan policies. Those are the policy basis our code has to be consistent with. Tab 7 has some material related to GMA, the key excerpts from statute and state guidelines. So this should be a pretty much go-to reference for the council, at least we hope so, in terms of reviewing the material in front of you now. Staff, of course, are happy to respond to any questions. Let us know. And then as the mayor described, and I think the city manager is working on specific dates where we will have a council member, this will be on the council agenda. So, Ben?
Thank you, Kevin. And then I think the mayor, deputy mayor, and I work on the schedule. Mayor, you want to go through the council calendar at this time, sir?
I'd be happy to, but before I do that, Councilmember Whitten had a question.
Can you give us a list of those evaluations forms that were, where there was a difference between staff recommendation and the Planning Commission?
I don't want to recount it for you right now, but
no, I know, but can you, I meant, would you provide us with a list of that?
Sure, we'd be happy.
And show us what the differences were.
Sure,
thank you.
We'll do that as a follow-up exercise.
Thank you, Cameron. Everyone should have in front of them a revised agenda calendar, which was in front of you this evening.
Get your fingerprints on.
There have been a number of changes made as a result of a discussion held earlier this week by the deputy mayor, myself, and the city manager. And fundamentally, what we decided to do is give ourselves five study sessions, if you will. They'll be a part, in some cases, they'll be part of a study session. In other cases, it'll be part of a regular meeting where we go to a study session. And the first one
meeting
of these will be on the 5th of November, 5th of March, pardon me.
November?
What's the rush? 5th of March, another one on the 12th, third one on the 18th. We'll skip April 2 for a couple of reasons. I won't go into. And then on April 9th and April 15th, there'll be two more.
If needed.
If needed. My suspicion is they may be needed, but let's hope for success here. We will have our first reading of a proposed ordinance on May 7th with the second reading scheduled for May 20th. That's assuming no major upsets in here and that the council stays focused on the issues that need discussion. Mr. City Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think that we could probably do it in three meetings, and then that's why the mayor, deputy mayor, and I thought that we put the if needed there. And it would be very helpful to us staff, prior to the meetings, as we discussed at the retreat, if you have questions, that you can send your questions in advance, then we're prepared to get you the best information, and then we can make your time use more wisely and be more helpful to you. So I encourage you to review the documents, and then please, please, please send us your questions prior to the meetings, so make sure that we get the information.
So refresh my memory when the individual meetings are going to be, which week we're shooting for.
I'm sorry, Mayor, did you?
The meetings with the council, the individual discussion sessions.
Yeah, and we are going to give that up.
2 weeks or so.
Yeah, and we haven't set that up, but I'm going to work. I think that Cameron has not been taking any vacation for a long time, so I thought we canceled all the vacations, but the personnel department told me that we need to take him some time off. So he's going to take a week or 10 days off. When he gets back, we're going to set up some also the individual council members. The purpose of those meetings is not to advocate one point of view or another, but rather to give you more one-on-one time to understand what is being proposed and presented to you by the Planning Commission.
So it's incumbent upon each of us to really dive into this book.
Yes.
In great detail. And prior to having the individual council meetings, develop a list of questions. Provide them to Cameron ahead of time, hopefully.
Yeah.
But if you can't, then we'll deal with it. But particularly when we get into discussions on, for instance, starting the 5th, if you have any questions for what's going to be discussed that evening, and we've yet to figure out how we break this up into blocks, digestible blocks, and you'll be advised of that. But please have your questions in ahead of time, because that will make the meetings go so much faster, and also have a probably a better quality answer for you than you might get on the fly. So I can't encourage that too strongly. I intend to spend a whole bunch of time on this in the next week, 10 days. So, Mr. City Manager?
And Mr. Mayor, also, I'd like to point out to Council, this is a following up the retreat to make our meetings more efficient. We put the timelines right next to each item in the agenda items. Mm-hmm. So, those timelines hopefully will help and guide us to get through the meetings more efficiently.
In the end of the future, when you get your agenda for the individual meetings, we will have rough time allocations for each individual subject. This is an effort to keep us on time and keep us focused on the discussions.
If we can finish early, is that permissible?
That's the whole idea, John.
Okay, just checking. Don't need to use every minute.
The balance will be team building.
No, we're not going to show. We're not going to show a test panel until we get to the subject. Okay. This evening.
There's none, Mr. Mayor. MO City Manager's report.
Okay. Go down the line from the council, starting on my right with Council Member Vance. Any comments?
Just to chime in with everyone else, I really appreciate the work that the Planning Commission has done. It looks like a great format. I'll be interested in digging into all of those controversial issues. Having been through two major projects myself in the Planning Commission, including the shoreline as well as the town center development plans. I know how hard it is to get through all that, so I really do appreciate it, all the hard work that you went through. I'll be looking through this very closely, and but again, I think we're getting off to a very good start in terms of just how the information has been put together. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I got my taste of government with the Shoreline Master Program, and there were lots of issues that needed to be addressed, and I do thank the commission and the leadership, the chair and co-chair, for working with, as the past deputy mayor and the current mayor, to try and arrive at a process that could make our deliberations easier, more concise, efficient, and come to a just conclusion that serves our city best. It's an arduous process. I wouldn't wish this on anybody, but I guess we're stuck with it.
Romero?
And I just want to reiterate again my thanks to the Planning Commission as a whole, as well as staff. It was thorough. It is very inclusive in attending a number of these meetings. I also wanted to cite not only the quality of the presentations that were given by the citizens and the vast quantity of information that wanted to be handled, but my hat's off to Kathy Richardson, Joe Lipinski, and Mike Luxenberg for not just the inclusiveness, but the civility that was demonstrated on a very emotional and sensitive topic to a lot of people. So I commend you on that, as well as the tools that you have developed. Thank you.
Nancy?
I don't need to repeat myself. I'm delighted to see a product that is as thorough and excellent and well-considered. So I want to thank you. I do have a concern about the equal rating. Because I feel the mandate under GMA is to protect the environment, and that's not equal with protecting property rights. I do think as a policy basis, we must balance, but I don't think they're necessarily equal in all circumstances. So, but I am absolutely delighted to have something that I can look at and say, yeah, that's great, I agree, or well, that raises a concern. And I mean, it's all there, so. Never had a product like this before on a complex issue, so I think this is just a really good way to go. Thank you.
John?
Just well done.
Excellent. I'll add my own to that. Well done, guys. And again, very appreciated. Acknowledge all work done by the commissioners, staff members, and all the hours of sitting in the chairs on the part of the of the public who have a vested interest in any of these issues, no matter what side of the ledger you're on. So I want to say job well done. I have a whole bunch of free time on my calendar because today I canceled the out-of-town trip I was going to be taking next week. So I've got lots of time to go and dive into this thing. So again, my thanks to everybody who's been involved in this process. I know that there's always a very good chance, if not an outstanding chance, of having a difference of opinion, and that's to be expected. But thank you. So, okay. So with that, I'm going to adjourn this session, and we'll see everybody back here on the 19th. Thank you. Adjourned.